إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، قال الله تعالى في قرآن الحكيم بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. صدق الله المولانا العظيم ورفعنا بالقرآن الحكيم. My dear brothers and sisters, we come once together to this blessed occasion of Jum'ah, full of awe and reverence for our Lord in our hearts, coming with the intention of celebrating and commemorating Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because He is the creator of the heavens and the earth, because He is the most merciful and the most compassionate, because He is the all-loving and the most kind and the most generous. And we praise Him because He is the most just, but His justice is not devoid of any of those qualities. And therefore we bear witness with full clarity on our tongues and full clarity in our hearts that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And we bear witness likewise that our beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came as a wave of mercy for this entire universe, that he did fulfill his message in full, that he was the most trustworthy, that he was the one who was the best of Allah's creation, and that he was the final of Allah's prophets and messengers sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam tasliman kathiran kathira. My brothers and sisters, this past Monday was Martin Luther King holiday, and it was also an opportunity for people from different parts of this country to participate in the beginning of yet another 4 years of the Obama administration in the inauguration that took place in Washington, D.C. at the Capitol. My wife and I were fortunate enough to make it down there to Washington, D.C. to stand in the cold and to enjoy the festivities. And I know that a lot of Muslims from this community and other communities went as well. And I think that it would be accurate for me to say that for those of us who were partaking in the celebration, that there were some mixed feelings, whether we were watching on television or we were standing there in the cold and watching what was happening, there were some mixed feelings. That on the one hand, there is the feeling that this country has made enormous progress on the issue of equality. It was quite startling to see that 150 years after the proclamation of emancipation of slaves in this country, and 50 years after Martin Luther King gave his I Have a Dream speech in almost the same location, that there would be an African American president who would take his oath of office for the second term, and that this country could get to a place within that period of time where it could vote for someone who is not white, who could vote for someone who only 150 years ago his ancestors were enslaved. And as Muslims, we have to really celebrate this achievement, not only as Americans, but also as Muslims, because our entire theology as Muslims is built on the notion that we find again and again in the Quran, that all of human beings are created min nafsin wahida, from one entity and from one soul. And because we are created from one soul, the very nature of the human being is equality. that there is no difference between men and women, and there is no difference between black and white in terms of their equality, in terms of their rank, not only in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it must also be in the eyes of our fellow men and women. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in his farewell khutbah, in the farewell sermon that he delivered on the top of the mountain at the time of the Hajj, he said to the Ummah that let it be known that there is no superiority of a white over a black, and no superiority of a black over a white, and that there is no superiority of an Arab over a non-Arab, and that there is no superiority over a non-Arab over an Arab. That this was one of the key moments that the Prophet ﷺ delivered in that farewell pilgrimage khutbah that he left this Ummah with. And therefore, as Muslims, we always have to be celebrating progress when it happens. But we also have to understand that just because President Obama was elected for a second time, that doesn't mean that we have now somehow fulfilled that mission of creating an equal society, or creating a society in which equality flourishes among people. We have to be realistic of the fact that it continues to be the case that there tends to be a larger segment of the minority population in this country that is living in the inner cities. It continues to be a fact that there is more of a minority population that continues to live in poverty. It continues to be a fact that there tends to be more of a minority population that are arrested and put into prisons for crimes that are relatively mundane compared to the crimes that are sometimes committed by people in the majority in this country, or people of wealth and privilege in this country. If you just think, for example, about the economic breakdown of this country and the role that people had in bringing down the entire economy and stealing from the wealth of people, and the punishment of those crimes, compared to somebody who is on the side of the street selling things that they may not be, that they shouldn't be selling, but they're selling it because they are in a situation of poverty and hopelessness. That those two crimes are by no means equal, and yet who gets the longer sentence? Yet who are the people who are concentrated in the prisons of the United States of America? It tends to be the minorities. So we should not be, you know, on the one hand we can celebrate, but on the one hand we should also not lose sight over what is happening within the society. We must not become befuddled, we must not become confused, and we must not think that that progress toward equality of human beings is by any means fulfilled. And so on the one hand you have this reality, and on the other hand you also have the reality that the mixed feelings come because this administration itself has engaged in many policies that I think any ethical human being would find quite deeply problematic. Whether it is at home, in the violation of the civil rights of human beings, or if it is in foreign policy, whether it is the stubborn support of Israel, even when it is clearly in the wrong, or whether it is in the support of drones that kill indiscriminately and have created havoc within certain societies. These are evils that we must call out as evil. And therefore we have to have this mixed feeling, or therefore there is this mixed feeling that we have at the beginning of this new term and administration. But my brothers and sisters, too often what happens in the Muslim community is that the reaction to this mixed feeling, the reaction to this reality that the world is not perfect, this reaction to this reality that by its very nature political governments are corrupt, and that by their very nature they're always deciding between different evils, and that they sometimes choose greater evils than lesser evils, is that too often the Muslim community turns away from political and civic participation. Too often the Muslim community becomes apathetic. Too often the Muslim community begins to deceive ourselves by saying that there is no use to being involved in politics or being involved in civic engagement. And my brothers and sisters, this is something that we have to oppose. We cannot be an apathetic community, but rather by our very nature, because we are followers of the Quran and we are followers of our beloved Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we have to be a community that is active, that is participating, not a community that is pathetic. We're not a community that is sitting back and letting other people do the work, but rather we have to be engaged. And the reason for that is because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the ethics of the community of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as being يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. This is the entire ethics of the Muslim community. If we are Muslims and we are followers of the Quran and we are followers of our beloved Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, then the entire ethics that we live according to should be built around this idea of يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, enjoining what is right, وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, and forbidding what is evil. This is the goal and the mission that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states for the Muslim community in verse after verse after verse. There are so many verses in the Quran that state and restate this mission over and over again. That if you want to be believers, then this is what you have to be involved in. You have to be involved in the encouragement of what is good, and you have to be involved in the forbidding of what is evil. And therefore, my brothers and sisters, what I would like to propose is that this idea of engaging, or this idea of confronting evil, that when we see evil in our midst, whether it is coming from a government or it is coming from some other entity, how is it that we should react to this as believers? If it is not the apathetic way, if it is not the way of apathy, then what is the way that we should react? And my contention is that if we look at the Quranic model, if we look at the Quranic model, what we will find is that there is no one solution fits all, but rather Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us many different models as to how we should be opposing wrong that is in our midst, how we should be opposing what is evil that is in our midst. And to give you just some examples of this, I want to direct your attention to the stories of three prophets that we find in the Quran. All three of them are prophets who had the role, the explicit role, of having to oppose tyranny or having to oppose a certain aspect of evil that was coming from the authority within their lands or within the lands that they found themselves in. And the first example that I want to give you is Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, who I term, when I think about this matter of what the role of the Muslim community is in opposing evil and injustice, is that I term him as the sincere intellectual. That Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, if you look at the way that he opposes this tyrant by the name of Nimrod, the way that he opposes him is by being a sincere intellectual. What is the dialogue that happens between Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam and Nimrod? Nimrod was an individual, was a tyrant, was a king who thought that he was the supreme master of the world. He thought of himself to be a god, just as Pharaoh thought of himself to be a god. This was a common problem that tyrants had, and this continues to be a common problem that tyrants have, is to think of themselves as all powerful and to take the place of God. And so, if you look at Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, the way he engaged is that he tried to reason with this tyrant. He tried to reason with his injustice. He tried to reason with his evil. And he said to the king, he said that, "My Lord grants life, and my Lord grants death. Can you grant such a thing? If you consider yourself to be a god, can you grant such a thing?" And the king, out of his arrogance, he takes two of his slaves. He slays one of them, and he allows one to live. And he says, "I too can grant life, and I too can grant death." This was the height of his arrogance and the height of his stupidity. But Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, he didn't stop there. Being the sincere intellectual, the person who engaged in reasoned debate, He went a step further and he said that my Lord causes the sun to rise from the east. Will you then cause the sun to rise from the west? If you really consider yourself to be the most powerful source in the dominion of the heavens and the earth, my Lord causes the sun to rise from the east, can you then cause the sun to rise from the west? Right? And he was defeated in his argument. He was shown to be weak. He was shown to in reality have no power whatsoever. If you have no power over the heavens, then what power do you have at all? So Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam, by playing the role of the sincere intellectual, he was able to oppose the injustice and the tyranny of his government, or the government that he found himself confronting. And it doesn't mean that the government then, you know, oh yes, Ibrahim, you're totally right, and now I will be a sincere monotheist. No, that's not what happens. What happens is that, you know, he loses the argument, and then he says, cast Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam out of this land. Right? And this is usually what happens to the sincere intellectual. The one who brings up intelligent argumentation, the one who brings up reasoned debate, that they can do that, but ultimately that doesn't mean that the other side is going to listen. But that is one model that the Quran gives us of opposing injustice within our societies. Now, being at Princeton University, being people who are engaged in policy making, being engaged in people who are studying history and social studies, you should be thinking about this model that Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam presents, the model of being the sincere intellectual, by opposing through argumentation and through reason the tyranny and the injustices of the society that we may find ourselves in. And then you have another model, and that model is in the model of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, in the model of Moses, Prophet Moses. And in my conception, I will term him as the sincere activist. Because what is the story of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam? He finds himself in the land of Egypt, living under the tyranny of Pharaoh. And after reaching a certain age, he is told by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to oppose the tyranny of Pharaoh and to call for the freedom of the children of Israel from this land of tyranny. And so what does Musa alayhi salatu wasalam do? It's very interesting to see what he does. The first thing is that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tasks him with this heavy responsibility of opposing injustice in his society, the first thing is that he has some hesitation. And what's his hesitation? His hesitation is that he says to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I might not be the best person for this job because I have a knot on my tongue that prevents me from speaking clearly. So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, being the wise man that he was, he understood that if he was to be in opposition to tyranny and injustice in his society, he would have to become a person of eloquence, and that he would have to become a person who could speak clearly, and that he had to be a person who could speak effectively. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a remedy for this, and he gave him a dua, and the dua is, Rabbi shrah li sadri. Oh Allah, open up my chest, open up my heart to guidance, to the light of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Rabbi shrah li sadri, wa yassir li amri, and make easy for me my task. رَبِّ شْرَحْ لِي سَدْرِي وَيَسِرْ لِي أَمْرِي رَبِّ شْرَحْ لِي سَدْرِي وَيَسِرْ لِي أَمْرِي وَحْلَلْ أُقْدَةً مِنْ لِسَانِي and remove the knot from my tongue يَفْقَهُ قَوْلِي so that they may understand what I am saying. This is the remedy that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave. And what is important in this is that the sincere activist in the form of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, he understood that he would have to have a clear message, that he would have to have clarity of message, that exactly what is it that he wanted to convey, and exactly what is it that he was demanding. All of this had to be clear, and therefore the clarity of communication, the clarity of the message, is one of the most important things that Musa alayhi salatu wasalam is showing us as being the sincere activist. But not only that, but he also says another thing which is very important in that dua. He says, and appoint for me my brother Harun as a supporter with me. This is very important because the sincere activist cannot go alone. The sincere activist needs to build a coalition. The sincere activist needs to build a brotherhood and a sisterhood of people who are willing to oppose the wrongs and the injustices of a situation and of a time and situation. And so he asks for his brother Harun to be part of his company, to be part and parcel of his team that would speak to Pharaoh. And then, not only that, but there's one other very important lesson, which is that after Musa alayhi salatu wasalam asks for clarity in speech, and after he asks for his brother's companionship in opposing injustice and evil, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him one very important thing. He says, go and speak to Pharaoh, but speak to him gently, so that maybe he will remember and maybe he will change his ways. And this is a very important lesson for us to think about, because so often, especially when, you know, the Muslim activist, they look really angry. Have you seen the Muslim activist? You know, it seems like they're gonna tear down some sort of wall and, you know, bring down the house, right? You know, you'll find the Muslim activist that they think that being an activist means shouting at the top of your lungs and shaking your fists and kicking a can. You know, it's a very exuberant expression. But what we find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells Musa alayhi salatu wasalam is that as a sincere activist, go and speak to Moses gently. Maybe he will remember, maybe he will change his ways. And so we have to learn from this that being an activist also means to be a person of gentleness, that it does not require somebody to get in your face and to act in necessarily a very aggressive way. And so this is the model of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. You have Ibrahim, the intellectual, you have Musa, the activist. But then you have a third. And this third one, I want you to really think about. I want you to really think about this third model. And that third model is in the model of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. Right? You all know the story of Yusuf. You all know the story of Joseph, peace be upon him. Right? What is his story? His story is that he is a young man. He sees a dream. And this dream indicates to him that he will be a prophet. He tells this to his father. His father says, you know, don't tell it to your brothers because they'll become jealous. His brothers were jealous anyways. And one day they leave him in a well. And they go back to the father and say, a wolf came and ate him up. And in reality, they have left him in a well. Lo and behold, a few people who are traveling on the journey, they come, they want to get some water from the well, and what do they find? They find this child, Yusuf, alayhi salatu wasalam, who comes out of the well, and they say, wow, we found a child. We will enslave him. We will make him a slave. And we will take him to the land of Egypt. And so, Yusuf, alayhi salatu wasalam, out of mere plots against him, so it wasn't pure coincidence, but out of mere plots against him, ends up inevitably in the land in which he is to one day, you know, speak to a tyrant. And we all know what happens after that. I don't want to go into details because the khutbah is not about Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. It's a beautiful story. Inshallah, one day we'll have a khutbah and a dars about that. But eventually what happens is that Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, because he opposed the temptations of his so-called master's wife, and people turned against him, he ended up languishing in prison for years and years. He ends up languishing in prison for years and years. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him the gift that he had from his childhood. That is the gift of dreams, of seeing dreams and being able to interpret dreams. And it is this gift of being able to see dreams and interpret dreams that eventually he wins his freedom from imprisonment. And not only that, but he becomes the treasurer of this same entity, of the same government that had put him in jail and that was, by and large, from what we can tell, an unjust system. So you have Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, who actually becomes part of the structure. And we will call him, according to this paradigm, the inside sincere reformer, the person who goes inside and sincerely tries to change things from within. And there is a role for this as well, that, you know, just because we find certain injustices within our society, it doesn't mean that we need to run to the furthest mountains, but rather there is also the role for the sincere inside reformer, the person who gets into the thick of things, gets their hands dirty, and tries their best to maintain the purity and the truth, even in the midst of injustice. And that they do it from the inside, that they do it from this internal mechanism. And if you look at Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam, he was quite brilliant, because he understood that in every society, the thing that people care about the most is the economy. And so he became quite literally the secretary of treasury for this entity. And that from within the society, from within the system, he tried to change things. That from within the society and within the system, he tried to change things. And so you have the model of Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. These are different models that Muslims have today. And it is important for us to use all of these models, because different people will be called to different things. And someone might find themselves to be an intellectual, someone might find themselves to be an activist, someone might find themselves to be an inside reformer. We are called to different things. But one thing we must never succumb to is apathy. Because the ethics of this religion is built on يَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ, to enjoin what is right and forbid what is evil. And I want to conclude the first part of this khutbah by highlighting this idea of enjoining what is right. Because we've been talking about forbidding what is evil, but let us not also forget that there are good things that are happening within our society, and that there might even be good things that are happening in public life. And that when good things are happening, even in those situations, it's not responsible for the Muslim community to sit by the wayside and to say, it's a great thing that good things are happening. No, but rather we have to participate. We have to participate in the good things that are happening. We have to participate in the good things that are happening and join the coalitions that need strengthening in encouraging and enjoining what is right. Enjoining what is right is as much a part of our ethical mandate as Muslims as opposing what is wrong and unjust and evil. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow us to see things as truth wherever it may exist. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us people of justice. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who are active in their societies, participating. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us among those who are effectively changing injustice and evil in their midst. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive us for our shortcomings, for He is the one who forgives all shortcomings. Astaghfiruhu, innahu huwal ghafurur rahim. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين على سيدنا وحبيبنا مولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My brothers and sisters, in the second part of the khutbah, which is very brief, I want to switch topics entirely, which is unlike what I usually do, because this is one thing that happened within our society that we need to reflect on, the beginning of another administration and the role of Muslims in civic participation. But there is another very important thing that has happened for the Muslim communities, the greatest of blessings, the anniversary of the greatest of blessings for this ummah. And that is this past Wednesday, our beloved Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was born on Rabiul Awwal, the 12th of Rabiul Awwal. And that this is an immense blessing for the Muslim community. And that this is a time for celebration for us. And it is a time of commemoration for us. And that no Muslim should ever become confused when people say that we do not celebrate the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hashar, do not say that. Do not allow your tongue to say that. Do not allow your heart to believe that. what certain people oppose within the ummah is having these official grand celebrations, and there's an argument for that, and there's a difference of opinion about that. But never say, and never allow your tongue to say, and never allow your heart to say that we do not celebrate the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because if there is anything worthy of celebration in our lives, it is the advent and the coming and the fulfillment of the prophecy of our beloved Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is inconceivable that we would celebrate our own birthday, or that we would celebrate the birthday of our family members or anybody, and we would not celebrate the birthday of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because a true believer is the believer who loves him, who loves the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam more than he or she loves even his own or her own self. This is a requirement of the fulfillment of faith itself. And my brothers and sisters, this is a time for us, because it is around the time of the birth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, for us to not only celebrate but commemorate. That we should examine within ourselves to what degree we are following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And not only to what degree are we following the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but to what degree are we even familiar with the life and with the character of our beloved Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How many a people there are that whose history we know in detail? How many a people there are whose character we know in depth? But do we know the history? Do we know the story? And do we know the character of our beloved Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this way, and even in a greater way than that? So in this month, let us renew our intentions to come closer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to develop a more beloved relationship with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and to engage in studying his life, not only his seerah, but also his shama'il. And this is what I want to conclude on. Too often, my brothers and sisters, Muslims know a basic outline of the seerah, but too often Muslims neglect the shama'il. Too often Muslims, they'll know from A to Z what happened during the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or at least they'll know some of the major events. And this is taught to us in our Sunday school, and so on and so forth. But do we really know the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How did he sleep? How did he wake up? How did he eat? How did he drink? How was he with his family? How was he with the young? How was he with the old? How was he with the poor and the weak? How was he with the rich and the powerful? How was he with his companions? How was he with his enemies? How was he with his Lord in the midst of the night? Do we know this? Do we know this? How familiar are we with it? And if we are not, and we can always become more familiar with it, then we need to not only engage the seerah, which is a history and a biography of the Prophet ﷺ, but we also need to engage the shama'il, which are details about how the Prophet ﷺ lived and his blessed character. Because, and why do we do all of this? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. That in the Messenger of Allah, you have the most beautiful model, أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. And who is it a most beautiful model for? Those who long for Allah and the last day in which they will meet their Lord. And those who remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala abundantly, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the most beautiful example. And so how much do we really know about how he lived and what his exalted character was like? إِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. The Prophet, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, testifies about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that indeed we placed you, O Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, on an exalted station of character. So are we familiar with his character? Are we familiar with his character? Are we familiar with the attributes that make him Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And so I would like to recommend for everyone two books. One is on the seerah. The book that I recommend on the seerah is written by Yahya Emmerich and is part of the Critical Life series. And it is a short, easy to read book, and it gives you a basic understanding of the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this is a good book. Oftentimes people will recommend much more complicated books like the blessed work of Martin Lings. But so often when people start reading that after a few pages and after looking at the dictionary, they get exhausted. And then they say, oh, this is maybe when I'm 50 years old, I'll read it. You know, so I don't want you guys to get, you know, caught in that. Read a very simple, easy to read biography of the Prophet ﷺ. It flows from one page to another. I enjoyed reading it immensely. Yahya Amrik, Critical Life Series, The Life and Works of the Prophet ﷺ. And then the second book is a 2-volume book that is written by Imam Sirajuddin, and it's easily available online, and it is called The Noble Characters of Our Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and it goes into what I was talking about. It goes into every single aspect of his life, how he ate, how he drank, how he sat with people, how he lived amongst his people, how he was with his Lord. It talks about every detail that you can imagine. And this is a very, very important and blessed book, and also very easy to read. And you can read it with your friends, you can read it with your family, and inshallah you'll have much benefit that comes out of it. So in this month in which he was born, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let us renew our intention to come closer to him and to develop these bonds of love. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that if you love me, then follow the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you. So let us be lovers in this month. Let us be lovers. Let us be lovers of Allah and lovers of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And let the lovers celebrate, and do not prevent the lovers from celebrating this beautiful month. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Rabbana atina fi dunya hasana wa fil akhirati hasana. Wa qina azab al-nar. Wa qina azab al-hashr. Wa qina azab al-qabr. ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكن خاسرين ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب اللهم اغفر لوالدي وللمؤمنين يوم يقوم الحساب اللهم اغفر لحينا وميتنا وشاهدنا وغائبنا وصغيرنا وكبيرنا وذكرنا وانثانا اللهم من أحييته منا فأحيه على الإسلام ومن توفيته منا فتوفه على الإيمان Oh Allah, we ask you during this blessed Jum'ah in particular to help those who are suffering throughout the world, the people of Syria, the people of Bahrain, the people, whoever they're struggling and they're suffering. Ya Allah, help them. Ya Allah, help them and make us among those who help them. Ya Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahumma ala sayyidina wa habibina maulana Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in wa aqim as-salah. Let us pray.
الله أكبر الله أكبر أشهد أن